Hi, and welcome to another Peaky Boardgamer's episode. My name is Atarakos, and tonight we're gaming in solo mode with Under Falling Skies, designed by Tomáš, Uhlíř. Now, for this one, I assure you, you're gonna spend an enjoyable hour from your life, so let's move to the table and see how the game is played. Start setup by choosing one of the three city tiles. These are double-sided, and you should use the blue side. Place the research marker in the starting space here next to the city. This symbol indicates which base tiles will be used, as well as which side of these base tiles. New York requires the C base tiles on top and the A base tile in the bottom. Place the yellow energy marker and the red damage marker in their corresponding starting spaces on the board. There's also a starting space for the excavator. Place the starting grey and white dice next to the board. Depending on the city you chose, you might need the blue dice as well, so set them aside for now. Above your city, you must place the four sky tiles in order, with darker tiles on top and lighter ones closer to your city. Sky tiles also have two sides. One side is greyish on the left, and it's the easy side, and the other one is reddish on the left, and it's the more difficult side. You may adjust the difficulty of the game by using more sky tiles on their difficult side. The normal game is with one difficult side. Choose the sky tiles that will be at their difficult side at random. Place the mothership tile above the top sky tile. Mothership tile has 5 drop points. Place the 5 purple ships on its drop point. Place the 4 additional white ships next to the board. The battle is now ready to commence. Earth is under attack. An alien mothership is invading our city, sending airships to attack. Airships will be approaching, and when they reach our city, they do 1 point of damage and they return back to the mothership. The player loses the game if the damage marker reaches the bottom space. The player also loses the game if the mothership tile reaches the row depicting the red skull here on the right. The player wins immediately if he manages to reach the top space of the research track before any of the just explained defeat conditions is triggered. The game is played in rounds, and each round has 3 phases. Phase 1 is the dice phase. The player rolls all his dice and then assigns all his dice one after the other in his base. Enemy airship movement might be triggered after placement of each one of these dice. Next we have the rooms phase. In this phase, the player resolves all the effects in the rooms he triggered with placement of his dice in the previous phase. Finally, we have the mothership phase. In this phase, mothership approaches, performs an action, and spawns ships. After this phase, the round is over and we continue playing another round. This continues until a victory or a defeat condition is triggered. Now let's make a step back and see gameplay in more detail. In the dice phase, the player first rolls all his dice and then he assigns his dice into spaces of his base. Important rule, all dice must be assigned to different columns. The excavator token divides the base to 2 parts, the excavated part and the not yet excavated part. Player normally assigns his dice in the excavated part of the base. However, one of the player's dice can be placed in the non-excavated part. This die will be used for digging deeper in the tunnel of the base with his excavator in the next phase. This will mean that the player will have more spaces for assigning his dice in the excavated part of the base. When the player assigns a die for excavating, he chooses a space that is ahead of the excavator. Important, empty spaces in the road are regarded as spaces. Then the player counts the spaces between the excavator and the selected space. The die that will be assigned must have an equal or a higher value than this distance. Using this die, any of these spaces would be legal placement. Now, after placing each one of his dice, the player must also perform the following steps. First of all, after assigning a die, the entire column is activated. All enemy airships that exist in this column, either in sky tiles or in mothership drop points, will move towards the player, spaces equal to the value of the die. So after assigning the 6 die in this column, this airship will move here, and this will move here. The only exception are turret spaces in the top row of the base. As it is also indicated on the space, assigning a die here will move all the airships one space less than the value of the die. That's the only effect of turret spaces. These have no other meaning in the next phase. If an enemy airship moves below the sky, then it attacks the player's city. The player receives one damage and the airship is removed and goes back to the mothership to be respawned later. As you can see, there are many enemy airship actions spread around the sky tiles. All enemy airships move simultaneously and they will trigger all the effects in the spaces where they will end their movement. If we have multiple effects, start resolving from top to bottom. Let's take a close look at these actions. Arrow spaces move the enemy airship one space in the depicted direction, unless there is another airship there, which in this case, the action has no effect. Moving to a space depicting a mothership moves the mothership one row towards the player. If there are enemy airships in the row where mothership will move, then all these airships will move on top of the mothership tile, but not on the drop points. Then the mothership tile moves to the next row. Finally, the explosion spaces do not trigger any effect. These are spaces where enemy airships are vulnerable to the player's attacks in the next phase. Last but not least, after placing a white die, a player must reroll all of the rest of his dice. In the rooms phase, the player resolves the effects of all the rooms he activated with his dice in the previous phase. The player resolves the effects of all the activated rooms in any order, and after he finishes with each room, he removes the die or dice outside of the board. As you can see, there are rooms that require only one die and some others that require two dice to be activated. These bigger rooms will not be activated in phase 2 unless they have all their spaces filled with a die. However, placing a die in one of these two spaces during phase 1 is allowed. Grey and white dice are called worker dice. Blue dice are robots, and we'll see in a bit how these come into play. When the player resolves the excavation die, he moves the excavator steps equal to the value of the die until it stops at the die's location. If the excavator hasn't got enough steps to reach the die, then it remains at the same place, the die is just discarded, and the excavation has no effect. However, in this example that's not the case, and the new excavator's location is this one, changing the excavated part of the base. The cost for excavation is one energy point, which is also depicted on the excavator itself. The grey turret rooms in the top row have no other effect in this phase, so we just discard the dice. For the rest activated rooms, we must calculate the value of the room, which is made of the value of the die plus or minus any modifiers depicted in the bottom of the room. In case of multi-dice rooms, the value is determined by adding both dice values plus the modifier. Also, the player must pay the energy cost that's depicted in the bottom of the room as well. So resolving this room will cost 1 energy, but resolving this one will cost 2 energy. If the player is unable to pay that cost, he may not resolve the room. For example, this player may not resolve that room until he has more energy. The player gains energy from yellow rooms. The player gains energy equal to the value of the yellow room. Here it's 2 energy and the die is discarded. In the green room, the player accumulates research points equal to the value of the room to advance in the research track, which is what he needs in order to win the game. Here the player must pay 2 energy and gains 5 research points. Player advances in the research track, spending the points he gained from the room. With these 5 points, the player may advance 2 steps in the research track. Spare points that are not enough to reach the next level are lost, so if the player had 6 research points, this one spare point would not be used. Red rooms are used to fight enemy airships. Here the room has a value of 5. The attack will eliminate all enemy airships that are currently located on spaces with the explosion symbol that has a value of equal or less than the room's value. With an attack of 5, these 2 airships will be eliminated, but not this one. White eliminated airships are placed next to the board, and red airships are placed on the mothership above the drop points. Finally, we're left with the blue rooms. Blue rooms will generate a robot die equal to the value of the room. So here, the player generates a 4-value robot. The new robot is then placed to any one room space of the excavated area, tilted like this to show it's exhausted. Exhausted means it cannot be used at the current phase, and this placement does not trigger enemy airship movement. At the end of the room's phase, all your robots are untilted and remain on the board so that they can be used at the next round. During the dice phase of the round where you assign your dice, you still have to place your worker dice in separate columns, not taking into account your robots. During the second phase, untilted robots may activate the room they're located. This is done exactly the same way, however, at the end of resolving the room, the robot decreases its value by 1 and it's also tilted to show it's exhausted. Robots may not be moved. They're normally discarded once their value would drop to 0. There are a couple more rules about robots. You can have up to 2 robots in play at the same time, and you can use robots to generate other robots. If you generate a robot but have no other robot remaining, then you can destroy one of your robots to regenerate it. Also, if the excavator moves behind the robot for any reason, then the robot is automatically destroyed. Last but not least, if a robot generates a new robot, the new robot can be the same robot that produced it. In this case, this robot produces a 2-value robot, which can either be this one or even the same one that can move to any excavated room, tilted. The mothership phase has 3 steps. First, the tile moves to the next row, and again, if there are any other airships in that row, they move on top of the tile. Then the mothership performs the action of the new row, if there is one. With this action, mothership produces a new white airship. With this action, the excavator is moved 1 step backwards in the player's base. With this action, the player's research marker drops by 1 step. With this action, the player receives a damage in his city. And finally, if mothership reaches this row, then the player automatically loses the game. In the third step, mothership spawns ships by moving them from the top part of the tile to the drop points. Mothership spawns red ships first before spawning white ships. The next priority is spawning ships to columns that are empty. So now one ship will be spawned here and one ship will be spawned in this one. If we had only one ship to spawn, the player chooses among these columns. If there are more ships to spawn, you choose columns with airships that are further away. So the last airship should move here. Again, if you have ships with equal distance, then the player chooses among these columns. So that was Under Falling Skies, and I have to say that the game comes with a lot of content and a 4-part campaign. The campaign is fully replayable, and as you combine different components and mechanics of the game, it feels as if it's different each time you replay it. That was the video for today. If you want to see more, please subscribe to my channel, and until next time, have fun and play more board games.